Morning. Nice to see all of you today. And all of you out there in Zoom and YouTube and Facebook, welcome. Glad to have you with us. Just a few announcements. First off, men, there's a sign up for you in the entryway. Sign up for breakfast next Saturday at 9, I believe, at Perkins. So sounds like a good time. Please sign up so we know how many are expected. The congregation will be voting on December 18th, right after the service, on consistory members for 2023. Just to give you a heads up, there will be a posting of those members on the bulletin board next week, so you know who is maybe coming on as new members and staying as members that are currently serving. So we just wanted to give you a heads up about that. There will be a Christmas Eve service, which we're very grateful for, 7 o'clock. We will not have a Christmas Day service this year. We will have a New Year's Day service on January 1st, and the celebration of communion for January will be the next Sunday on the 8th, since some folks may not make it on the 1st. Hopefully everybody will, but we will have communion on the 8th. So just to kind of give folks an idea, we're grateful that we can have communion today. I'd just like to thank Leanne and Greta for providing our goodies today after the service. Thank you very much. Please join us in the fellowship hall after the service today. Just a reminder that the tree that's in the entryway, as soon as you walk in, is for cards. So if you'd like to bring a card for the congregation, that's what it's there for. If you want to send one to everybody, that's fine too, but that's actually a tree for cards. So people can put your card there, read the cards that everyone else has hung on the tree, and it's our fellowship Christmas tree. So please use it for that. Just a couple of announcements about folks that we need to prayerfully think about over these next few weeks. Jackie Dietz, many of you knew Jackie. She had been our administrative assistant for years, a member of our church. Marge is her mother. We need to keep her in prayer. Many of you may know that she's has battled cancer for a while now, and we need to just continue to keep her in prayer as she considers many things that may be changing in her life. The other one is Irving called George Kohler last night and Dolly to see how they were. George had just walked into the house after being at the hospital with Dolly, who was admitted again with pneumonia, so we need to keep them in prayer. And we're grateful that, Pastor, you were able to talk to George so that we know what's going on with them. So keep them in prayer as well, and all those others that we know of that are hurting and suffering and sad, even during this joyous time of year. Are there any other announcements? Have a blessed day. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Please join us in the call to worship this morning. A voice cries out in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make God's path straight.
Every valley will be filled, and every mountain will be leveled.
The crooked will be made straight. The rough and rocky ways will be smoothed. Join us in the singing of One Candle Is Lit.
Come surely, Lord Jesus, as dawn follows night.
Our hearts long to greet you as roses the light. Salvation, draw near us, our vision engage. One candle is lit for the hope of the age. Come quickly, Shalom, teach us how to prepare for a gift that compels us with justice to care. Our spirits are restless till sin and war cease. One candle is lit for the reign of God's peace.
Good morning. Please join me in the prayer of invocation. Let us pray together. Blessed is our God, and blessed are God's gifts, that grace us with forgiveness and every good gift. Lord, you have come to dwell within us. Build your temple within our hearts, and we will worship you in spirit and in truth. Amen. In our opening songs of praise, O Come, Emmanuel.
Spring, come and change. Morning. Please join me in the prayer of confession. O Lord, darkness surrounds us like a cold stone tomb until your light bursts into our lives like a clear, bright dawn. Your light blazes forth like a white-hot fire, consuming all that it touches. How can we stand before you, Lord? The road that we thought was straight and wide is now exposed as twisted, crooked path blocked by a mountain of sin. Where can we turn? Who will guide us back to the way of peace, the way that leads to you? Amen. Please stand for the Gloria Patri.
Seated. Praise the Lord. Our scripture reading for today is found in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 through 18, and I believe we're reading that from the New International Version. Here's how God's word reads today. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at the time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. By setting aside his flesh, the law with its commands and regulations, his purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. God bless the reading of his word to us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you because of what you've given to us. You have given us peace. I pray, Lord, that today, Lord God, you make that a reality in our minds, in our hearts, in our spirits. I pray, Lord God, that you would speak to us. Put man aside and place yourself, Lord God. We need to hear from you. Help us to hear that which you have for us. Bless us now. And let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable unto thy sight, O Lord, my God, and my Redeemer. Amen and amen. Praise God. I had titled the message this morning, God's Masterpiece. And in the word masterpiece, we put P-E-A-C-E, which is what I'm going to be talking to you today about, God's peace, the peace that he has for us. And it's important for us to understand that, because as Jesus said, and he said this very clearly in John chapter 14, verse 27, very important words Jesus says, and very important for us to understand. And I hope and pray that some way, somehow, by the time I get through sharing with you this message, that you will come away understanding what Jesus was actually saying. Because it can sound simple if we just think of it as the way we think of peace here. But here's what it says. And I'm reading from a modern translation. It says, I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. If you read that in your old English translation, the King James, he said, my peace I give to you, not as the world giveth I unto you. But he's saying, I'm leaving a gift to you. And it's a gift of peace of mind and heart. And the peace that I'm giving you, the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. And that's the legacy that Christ leaves for us. He leaves a legacy of peace, a remedy for anxiety, a cure for the troubled heart. And we have a lot of hearts that are troubled today. We have a lot of anxiety today. We have a lot of people trying to find peace in their souls, in their hearts, in their minds, and not succeeding. Now, the Bible tells us, and Paul the Apostle, when he writes to the church at Rome, he explains to them where we were at before Christ. In other words, how we stood before God. And the way Paul describes it in Romans chapter 8, he describes it as we at one time were enemies of God. We were in hostility against God. The way he describes it in Rome, in the letter to the Romans, it says that we had lived by the flesh, and since we lived by the flesh, we were hostile with God. In other words, our flesh don't want God. Our flesh doesn't desire God. Our flesh desires its own way and to do its own thing. And that is what's brought about that hostility between God. But in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, it reads, therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus has done for us. You got to meditate on that and stay with that a little bit to understand what did Jesus actually do for us. Basically, what that verse is saying, that through Christ's sacrifice, through what Jesus did for us, he gave us an entrance into the presence of God. In other words, he opened up the way so that we can go before God without feeling afraid, without feeling that we are an enemy, but we are being brought before God through Jesus Christ. And what we are finding when we come before God is that hostility has been dealt with. That hostility has been put away. And now we find grace. Now we find peace with God. But before that we had no peace, as the scripture and as Jesus has stated, my peace I give you, not like the world gives peace, I give you peace. He gives us a peace that passes all understanding. He gives us a peace within our heart and souls that there could be chaos all around us, but deep inside, we are experiencing that tranquility. We are experiencing that peace, that rest in God. Remember that illustration of that little girl in kindergarten, where the teacher asked, you know, and I gave this a couple of weeks ago, where the teacher asked the students, draw me a picture of peace. And all the kids began with their crayons. Some drew pictures of mountains, trees, a river flowing, the sun shining. All the kids drew their own picture. But then there was this little girl who was going like this on the paper. And the teacher noticed it. So the teacher went over and looked over her shoulder to see what was the picture she drew. And all she saw on the page was this crayon mark in dark all over the page. And the teacher asked the little girl, says, I asked for a picture of peace. What are you doing? And she says, that's a picture of peace. And when the teacher got a closer look, there was a little bird sitting on a branch quietly. You understand what I'm trying to say to you? We live in a chaotic world. We live in a messed up world. We live in confusion all around us. But in the midst of that, God is promising us peace. A peace. That's why the scripture says it's a peace that passes all understanding. Not like the world gives. God gives to us that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of trouble, in the midst of whatever we're going through, God will put a peace inside of us. And that's the peace that we need. And where is this place of peace? It's a place where Jesus rules. Jesus is the ultimate peacemaker. Ephesians 2:15 says that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace. God has designed a perfect way for peace, and it involves his masterpiece for our masterpiece, and that is the church. Yeah, we live in an age of confusion. We live in an age of darkness, that it's dangerous. And what the writer of Ephesians, Paul, is saying to us is that the church offers to us the only thing that could ultimately dispel this darkness, this confusion. In the Old Testament, in Isaiah chapter 6, we find an interesting event. Isaiah the prophet had as the king as his friend. And King Uzziah was now on a campaign to turn back Israel to God. But then he died. And Isaiah was confused. Isaiah's life fell in turmoil. He didn't know what to do. But he goes into the temple, the Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 6. And in the temple, Isaiah has a powerful experience that transforms his life. Let me tell you something, the greatest place in the world to have a powerful experience, although you can have it anywhere in the world, but it's in the house of God. I've had great experiences in God's house that have brought peace to my heart and my soul more than any other place in the planet. And so we find in the passage that Isaiah goes into the temple and he's in search for an answer, for a clearer understanding of what the future is going to be like. And there in the temple, we read that Isaiah has a vision. He has a vision of God. He has a vision, and the vision that he has, it's God sitting on his throne and the angels worshiping. He has a vision of God in control. He has not a vision of a God walking up and down his throne and scratching his head and wondering what to do with the world. No. He sees a vision of God in control. He sees a vision of God sitting on his throne. Yeah, the king had died. The king who wanted to turn things around had died. But the King of Kings was still alive. The King of Kings was still on his throne. And that's what Isaiah sees. So Isaiah has a vision of God in control, has a vision of God on his throne. But beyond that, he not only has a vision of God, but he has a vision of himself. You see, that's what happens when we come into the presence of God. All of a sudden, we see not only God, but we see our own selves. And what he sees himself in confusion, in trouble. And he says, "Woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips." And he has this experience. Not only he has a vision of God on his throne, but he has a vision of himself and his condition. But then the vision goes on, and beyond that, he sees a vision of God transforming his life and taking control of him. What a powerful experience Isaiah is having. A vision of God, a vision of the world, of the how messed up the world is, a vision of himself, how messed up he is, and then a vision of God transforming his whole life. Isaiah left the temple with the great void in his life filled. Are you hearing me? There is a relationship which makes life complete. Without that relationship, there is a void and a vacuum in many people. Even people who are well-known and well-educated have been able to express themselves about living on this planet outside of Christ. H.G. Wells, the famous historian and philosopher at age 61, he writes, "I have no peace. All life at the end of thither. All life is at the end of thither." The poet Bryan said, "My days are in yellow leaf. The flowers and fruits of life are gone, and the worm and the canker and the grief are mine alone." The literary genius Thoreau, he said, "Most men live lives of quiet desperation." That's our world, an emptiness. And that's the way the world people are living even today. Ralph Barton, one of the top cartoonists of his day, left this note pinned to his pillow before taking his own life. He said, I have had a few difficulties, making many friends, great successes. I have gone from wife to wife, from house to house, visited the great countries of the world, but I am fed up with inventing devices to fill up the 24 hours of the day. How sad. There was a sign on a doorpost of a church in New York and the sign read outside the door of the church, "Gone out of business. Didn't know what our business was." The wisest man that ever lived said that without a vision, people will perish without having a purpose. In the Message, it reads this way in Proverbs 29:18. If people cannot see what God is doing, they stumble over themselves. But when they attend to what God is revealing, they are most blessed. Outside of Christ, folks, outside of God, there's just confusion. There's just emptiness, purposeless. Chronicles 7:14, famous passage. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. You ever wonder why our land has not healed? Charles Wesley, who was one of the pioneers of the Methodist Church, along with his brother John Wesley, great songwriter, he wrote, "I rest beneath the Almighty's shade. My griefs expire, my troubles cease. Thou, Lord, on whom my soul is stayed, will keep me still in perfect peace." Safety consists not in the absence of danger, but in the presence of God. Society of International Law of London, they state that during the last 4,000 years, there have been only 268 years of peace in spite of the good peace treaties. Did you get that? 4,000 years. The last 4,000 years, there's only been 268 years of peace. In the last three centuries, there have been 286 wars on the continent of Europe alone. Again, the peace that Jesus gives is not the absence of trouble, but it is rather the confidence that he is there with you always. Are you hearing me, folks? There is a verse in the Bible, in the last chapter of Romans, chapter 16, where Paul the Apostle has been encouraging the Christians of Rome to hang in there, knowing that they're going to be persecuted, knowing that they're going to go through some real tough times. But he reminds them of the prophecy that God gave Eve in the garden. And Paul describes it, and he says, "And the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet." And so what he's saying there, he's saying several things. First of all, after warning about strife and dissension and discord, he reminds them that God is a God of peace, and he will bring ultimate unity to the church and destroy all of the conflicts that are there. Hey, listen, we live at a time when the church has so much conflict, so much division. in the church. No wonder the young people are staying away. They just can't understand what's all the fighting about. Why isn't there any unity? But the Lord is promising, and God is promising, and we have this in the book of Ephesians, that God will bring about a unity, a peace within the church itself. I believe that. I don't believe the church is going to continue in the way it is. I believe there's a wake-up call coming, and it's coming pretty soon, where the church will finally wake up and say, we need to be together. We need to be united. Second, Paul describes this great work of God as crushing Satan, which is the promise that he had given to Eve. He will bruise the head. And the third, he will crush Satan under your feet. What is he talking about? He's talking about you and me. Fourth, he says, and it will happen soon. The decisive victory was won at Calvary. And the ultimate doom of Satan is sure. Let me close today in reading a passage of scripture in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, to 11. Let me read that to you. I think we're going to get it up on the screen. Oh, we do have it. Thank you, Tom. I just want to close with this passage of scripture. Here's what it says. Be alert. I like it in another translation where it says, be cool. I got that translation. It says, be cool, stay cool, chill. That's not an Irving's translation. That's a modern translation. It says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil. And the other translation said, he's out to pounce on you. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to pounce on. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Leave that verse up there for a little bit, because we need to look at it. You need to see it. It's what God's word. These are not my words. This is what the Lord is saying. Lord is saying, hey, you're going through some stuff. You're going through some real stuff in your life. But hey, I'm going to come through for you. I'm going to make you strong. I'm going to keep you firm. Again, it's not the absence of trouble. It's the presence of God in the midst of trouble. He said, lo, I am with you always, even until the ends of the earth, the Lord has promised to be with us. Are you with me? He said he will put us together and get us back on our feet. Those are his words to us. Yes, he will do that. Hey, I end with the words, the same words that Jesus, that I began with, the words of Jesus. My peace I give to you as a gift. Not like the world, I'll give to you. That's what God is offering us. So in the midst of whatever's going on around us, we can experience God's peace. You see, the Bible tells us clearly that the Lord had rent the veil that separated all of the people from the presence of God. But at the cross, that veil was rent. And now we can enter the presence of God. We can enjoy the presence of God where there's peace. There is peace in the presence of God. Let's stay there. Let's linger there. Let's be in God's presence. Do that daily. Go into the presence of God every day. Stay there, watch Him carry you throughout the day with His perfect peace. Amen? Praise God. We're going to transition at this time to Holy Communion. So those of you who are here, you can grab hold of this laminated card. And those of you at home, you can watch it on the screen. And I thank the Crowthers for this wonderful gift. It's so beautiful. It says, with God, all things are possible. All things are possible with God. Amen. And boy, does Irving need this so much. Thank you. Those of you at home, you may, if you haven't, run over to your kitchen and get yourself some juice, get a bread or crackers, whatever you can get, and join with us in this Holy Communion as we get ready to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Supper we're about to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, of communion, and of hope.
Lord Jesus Christ was sent by the Father into the world to assume our flesh and blood and to fulfill for us all obedience to divine law, even to the bitter and shameful death of the cross.
By his death, resurrection, and ascension, he established a new and eternal covenant of grace and reconciliation that we might be accepted by God and never be forsaken.
We come to have communion with the same Christ who has promised to be with us always, even to the end of the world.
In the breaking of the bread, he makes himself known to us as the true heavenly bread that strengthens us unto life eternal. In the cup of blessing, he comes to us as the vine in whom we must abide if we're to bear fruit.
We come in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are a pledge and foretaste of the feast of love, of which we shall partake when his kingdom has fully come, when with unveiled face we shall behold him, made like him in his glory.
Since by his death, resurrection, and ascension he has obtained for us the life-giving Spirit, who unites us all in one body, so are we to receive this supper in true Christian love, mindful of the communion of saints. Come, for all things are now ready. Do you have a communion song there at this time? Let's hear that song.
Is my body given for you? This is the cup that holds the blood of a new covenant. This is forgiveness, simple and true. This is the way that I have made for you. Before you eat, before you drink, take a long look inside and tell me what you see. He said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the bread of the new put out the new. This is the Son of God who died for you. Before you eat, before you drink, take a long look inside and tell me what you see.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
For it is holy and right to do so.
Holy and right it is, and joyfully, and our joyful duty, to give thanks to you at all times and in all places. O Lord, our Creator, almighty and everlasting God, you created heaven with all its hosts, and the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being and preserve us by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus Christ, the eternal Word made flesh for us and for our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God, with your whole church on earth, and with all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name, saying,
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna is the highest.
Most righteous God, we remember in this supper the perfect sacrifice offered once on the cross by our Lord Jesus Christ for the sin of the whole world. In the joy of his resurrection and in expectation of his coming again, we offer ourselves to you as a holy and living sacrifice. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, we pray, that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be to us the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. Grant that, being joined together in him, we may attain to the unity of the faith and grow up in all things into Christ our Lord. And as this grain has been gathered from many fields into one loaf, these grapes from many hills into one cup, grant, O Lord, that your whole church may soon be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Jesus on the night in which he was going to be betrayed. He met with his disciples and he had the supper. And as he was listening to them, talking among themselves and all that, there wasn't any unity. They weren't understanding what he was saying and what he had just finished telling them, that he was going to go to Jerusalem and that he was going to be tortured and crucified. But on the third day, he will rise again. They missed all that. And since they were missing it, he looks down at the table and he sees the bread and he picks up the bread from the table. And he says to them, he breaks the bread and says to them, this is my body which is broken for you. And as often as you eat this bread, you do this in remembrance of me. And he said to them, eat all of you the bread. And in the same manner, he took the cup and he said to them, this is the new covenant in my blood. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. The cup of blessing which we bless is the communion of the blood of Christ. Drink all of you the cup. Our communion thanksgiving. Brothers and sisters, since the Lord has now fed us at his table, let us together praise God's holy name with heartfelt thanksgiving. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your iniquity.
Who heals all your diseases.
Who redeems your life from the pit.
Who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
The Lord is merciful and gracious.
Slow to anger and abounding steadfast love.
He does not deal with us according to our sins.
Nor requite us according to our iniquities.
For as the heavens are high above the earth,
so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him.
As far as the east is from the west,
so far does he remove our transgressions from us.
As a father pities his children,
so the Lord pities those who fear him.
Who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, and will also give us all things with him.
Therefore shall my mouth and heart show forth the praise of the Lord from this time forth forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray for our world, all the troubles and all the things that are happening. Hey, listen, God has called us to be the salt of the earth. And he said that if the salt loses its flavor and saltiness, the world is in trouble. Without a body of believers praying and interceding for the world is in trouble. The world's in big trouble. Thank God for the body of Christ that prays for the world. We intercede, and because of our intercession, God preserves the world. If you know someone who's hurting, someone who's in trouble, if you know a family that's probably going through a hard time right now, and many are, if you know someone who's sick and afflicted, we know people. We pray for Dolly. We pray for George, who also had a fall this past week. We pray. Dolly's in the hospital with pneumonia. Pray for Daryl. Pray for Jackie Dietz. He's home from the hospital, but in a lot of pain and still struggling. There are so many that we are praying for. We have a list of folks that we have been praying for. We want to continue to pray for these folks. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we come before thee knowing, O God, that you're a God that is moved by our infirmities. You are moved by the things that we're concerned about and hurt us and disturb us. Father, you are moved by our loved ones who are suffering and those we have mentioned. Father, we pray for healing. We pray for deliverance. We pray, Lord God, for George. We pray, O God, for Dolly and Daryl and Jackie, Lord God. We pray for George Rosado. We pray for many others, O God, who have asked for prayer at this time. We pray for families that are struggling right now and that are hurting. We pray for healing. We pray for deliverance. We pray for salvation. We pray, Lord God, that you would undertake for these families, Lord. And we won't fail to thank you and give you praise and honor, Lord. Thank you for these things. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Praise God. We have a closing song, don't you?
Thank you. our peace, who has broken down every wall. He is our
that I forgot, you know, and it's the part that is for me, and that part is that God has called us to be peacemakers, and I confess I've been having a hard time with that. I've stopped the war because our war is with God. And the war ends when you surrender to God. My war has ended. I have surrendered to God. And God, and I've experienced God's peace between Him and myself. But is sharing that peace, being a peacemaker, is where I have struggled. And I keep praying and asking God, Lord, help me be a peacemaker. Because He said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall obtain mercy from God. Let's be peacemakers in a world that just doesn't get it. Amen? Can you stand with me, please, as we get ready to go and have some fellowship together? So come and join us for some fellowship. That's the most important time in the whole service. People think that the most important time is what happened just now. Yeah, that's important. But more importantly is that we connect with one another. And that's what happens in our fellowship hall. So please join us. Those of you at home, thank you for joining us on Facebook, on Zoom, and YouTube. God bless you. Please share this message with those who perhaps maybe need to hear a message about peace. Feel free to do that. Amen. And we hope we can see you soon in our church sometime soon. God bless you. May the Lord be with you. May He watch over you. May He take you to your destination safely. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. Have a great day.